Let me explain to you how to read the graph, because it's the exact opposite psychologically of a stock market graph. I think when you look at a stock market, most of us want it to go up, not down. In this game, we want it to go down. The higher states of novelty occur as you approach zero. So this is the most novel point on the screen. This is the most habit impacted moment on the screen. And what you see is habit and novelty are at war with each other. Now, here's how I interpret this particular screen, and it is a basis for interpreting all the rest. This is a turning point. After a long period of habit, consolidation, and recidivism, whatever that means at 4.7 billion years ago, something very novel happened along this descent. I maintain that it's actually the stabilization of the surface of the Earth itself. That what we're seeing here is the Earth changing into a stable planetary body. And then the earliest forms of life, the proto-life, appears right here and undergoes a series then of fluctuations. Then there is some kind of a problem, some impediment to what would otherwise be the rather straight shot toward novelty by this spike here. Well, evolutionary biologists say that in the early history of the Earth, there was a crisis having to do with the production of oxygen as a waste gas. Life arose in a non-reducing atmosphere. The first pollution crisis in the history of the Earth was pollution by oxygen. And organisms had to develop complex membranes and mechanisms for dealing with this. And that's what happened along here. And once that was achieved, then the pace of novelty quickened and the descent continued. And we, our entire civilization, in fact, you know, the last million years, as a matter of fact, is lost down here in this stochastic fluctuation near the zero point. In other words, relative to these places in the wave, we're so near the maximum of novelty that it's practically punching in through the walls. And in fact, human civilization correctly mirrors that. I mean, where you would expect to find a civilization on this graph is somewhere down in here. Well, now, if everything is working right...
Are you at the 98.8%?
98.8% is the target date of today. Now, what I'm going to do is there's a zoom function here, and we're going to start flying toward the present. And every time a screen changes, we're going to see half as much time on the screen. We have 6 billion years up, we'll go to 3, then 1.5, then 0.75, and so forth. This seems to be an excellent computer with a fast chip, so...
we're going to be seeing the right hand?
Yeah. And we're going to get greater and greater detail. And your attitude toward this should be, I'm asserting that this is true. You have a notion of where the high points in evolutionary and human history have occurred. You should be asking yourself whether this fits your intuition. Now, obviously, it's pretty vague stuff when we're looking at 6 billion years. But on the other hand, we can take this thing down to 3 days if necessary. And we know where the great changes have come in the last 1,000 years. It's not that ambiguous. So let's test the zoom function. Zoom, it asks me. Yes, I reply. Seek minimum, it asks me. No, I reply. Approach factor, it asks me. And I'm going to tell it 2 in order to have the screen each time. It would accept any number, but 2 seems rational for demonstration purposes. No, it's going to slice the time. It's going to slice it each time and rescale.
I'm just coming up with minute and hour and day instead of year.
So is the origin of time here also like the origin of the universe?
You would presume so.
So the Big Bang would kind of like be in the middle.
the Big Bang would be, no, the Big Bang would be very high because there's no life, there's no atomic systems, there's no molecules. It's a very low complexity situation at the birth of the universe.
That's not the graph, though.
Yeah, no, yes, that's right. The Big Bang is somewhere up here, up here. Okay, now before I do this, let me locate escape, okay. This is such a pleasure to do it with fast machines. Okay, there's 3 billion. See how detail is coming up as time is lost? And if anybody wants me to stop it at any point, I will.
That's one and a half, just read off what it is as it goes along.
Here's 750 million years. This is virtually the entire history of life on Earth. And in fact, of higher life, I'm sorry, you know, organisms, not multicellular life. This is the history of multicellular life. And what you see is there was a steep descent into novelty until about 300 million years ago. And then there were, are a series of oscillations close to zero until about 65 million years ago. And then there's a sudden plunge deeper into novelty immediately preceding the concrescence, which occurs on at dawn, Greenwich Mean Time, December 22nd, 2012. One thing about this theory, it's not vague. And it notice that it doesn't hedge on predictions either. It fills every screen is full of predictions. Two. Approach factor, yeah. Okay, we've got 750 million years on the screen, 375 million years on the screen. Now I want to talk about this for a minute. Now this is a screen full of dramatic predictions. These are tremendously punctuated and temporally defined plunges into novelty. And we don't have tremendous paleontological records for what's going on 275 million years ago. But from studying these low points and talking to geochronologists about them, I've decided that these are planetesimal impacts on the Earth. Now, you know that the last one was 65 million years ago. That's this one right there. But there were others. There was one, this one, 220 million years ago.
Terence, can you define
planets? Oh, asteroid strikes on the Earth.
I thought you said there was one closer than 65 million years
ago. Oh, well, there was a little tiny one in Arizona. Those happen all the time in cosmic terms, every 100,000 years or so. But this thing that happened 65 million years ago was a planet shatterer. And they're rare. They're rare. Okay, so I'm suggesting that these are asteroid impacts, which then evolution has to restart, reclaim its territory, and then there is something else happening. They may not all be asteroid impacts. They could be, you know, enormous episodes of volcanism on the Earth, such as the Deccan Traps in India or something like that. Now let's start the thing again.
And that was how many million? 350?
What we're looking at now? 375. Okay. Seek minimum? No. Approach factor? 2. Go for it. That's 187 million years. There's the impact 65 million years ago. Now let's look at this. This is the last 93 million years. Ah, yes, it looks like the thing we started out with. Somebody's paying attention. Right on. Yes, yes. See, what happens is a fractal is a nested data set, and every time you pass through a whole number, the pattern repeats. This sets up a very interesting set of circumstances inside the wave, which is that we can talk about temporal resonance. We can talk about how the Third Reich is a resonance of ancient Egypt. We can talk about Saddam Hussein as a resonance of Mohammed. Because when we look at the way these things are lined up historically, we see that directly above Saddam Hussein and in a relationship of parallelism is the career of the prophet. And so what is being suggested here is that every day, every moment, is in fact an interference pattern created by other times and places. This is a fairly challenging and peculiar idea, not something the linear Western mind would have ever come up with. So, for instance, if you should find yourself having lunch in a place called Hadrian's Hamburger Stand, this has something to do with the Emperor Hadrian and his 4-year military campaign in Scotland. He is a direct causal influence on your being at Hadrian's Hamburger Stand for lunch. I like to say, Rome falls 9 times an hour. And you have to be perceptive. You have to be paying attention to the ebb and flow of your own inner thoughts. But if you are, you feel the fall of Rome. You also feel the age of exploration, of the birth of Buddha, the fall of Carthage. It all happens 9 times an hour. It also happens twice a day and once a year. Yeah.
Have you done any correlation?
Sometimes, yeah, it is very similar. That's right.
If you check in and you were playing with astrologers where the planetary positions were at 2 events in history.
Yeah, we've never tried to do it scientifically, you know, where you would actually keep track, but major astrological conjunctions are often reflected in major ingressions into novelty.
Terence, yeah. Interestingly, if you or anyone else that's aware of this ever tried to convolve this with say, Einstein's field equations?
No, because I'm not smart enough to do that.
I think it would be a fascinating thing to do because what you're doing is you're input using as one of the variables this entire system.
That's right.
And what it would produce would be fascinating.
I think God has chosen you for this work.
Finally, about Saddam Hussein, just makes me ask, what are the historical antecedents of Reagan and Bush?
Oh, well, Ronald Reagan was, his historical antecedents were the last 6 Roman emperors before the fall of Rome in 475. And Bush's antecedent is...
It must be Caligula, right?
I think Bush gets to be Justinian. You remember somebody said history always occurs twice, first as tragedy, then as farce? That person had a good intuitive... So now let's go into this a little more. How much time do we have? Oh, 93 million years. Okay, so here's the asteroid impact and dead on. I mean, 65 million years is right there. To the degree that we can date these two events, it's a winner. It's a bullseye. And, it was a huge setback for organic life. As I said this morning, nothing larger than a chicken survived it. The mammals began their radiation, and these are, you know, just different vicissitudes. I'm not sure what to make of this spike here, but I haven't really spent a lot of time on that period from 40 to 36 million years ago. Somebody else may have a notion as to what this represents.
It looks like the recovery, though, was fairly rapid.
Which it was. Evolutionary biologists say, you know, that forms quickly reoccupied all the niches. And remember, if this hadn't happened, we wouldn't be the planetary rulers that we are. We'd still be little furry creatures trying to steal eggs out of the nests of the Saurian masters who ruled the planet. Why? Because all the dinosaurs were killed in this impact, and that allowed these little egg-stealing, rodent-like, furry creatures to undergo an explosive evolutionary radiation, leading directly to our own vast superiority over the rest of nature. Oh, well, that's a whole different scale. You see, the dinosaurs died off 65 million years ago. The ice ages are a phenomenon of the last 5 million years. And we'll see the ice ages, but not there. Right now, those ice ages are down in here, somewhere lost in the detail. Let's go back to our Zoom.
We'll get there, won't we?
Oh, yeah, we'll get there.
I'm waiting for you to get to my writing slot.
Don't worry. No, we don't want to seek the minimum. The approach factor should be 2. Okay, 93 million years on the screen, 46 million years on the screen, 23 million, 11 million, 5 million, 5 million years on the screen. Now, here are your ice ages. Here they are. You see, when the ice is in place, species are bottled up and gene transfer is impeded. This constitutes a non-novel situation. Then when the ice melts, these gene pools re-encounter each other and you get proliferation of form. We're getting excellent agreement here. This is the melting of the last glacier. Maybe.
I'm not, the last glacier was about 13,000 years ago.
Yeah, I think it's actually over here, still lost in detail. But these are, you know how evolution is described as punctuated? How it isn't that evolution proceeds smoothly, but there will be a climaxed stasis, and then suddenly many new species. Well, these are the punctuated evolution. This is actually a picture of punctuated evolution. And the high numbers of species are down in these troughs. And the low numbers of species are on these ascents close to the changeover points. So, again, the paleontological data isn't that clear, but at this scale of resolution, we're getting good agreement between data and theory.
Are these different nests identical in both amplitude and phase? Do you know? I mean, can they be done? In other words, can you take this section that you're looking at, superimpose it over this other nest, and have it overlay identically, or the phase?
Well, they are topologically equivalent,
right,
but not numerically equivalent.
Right. Amplitude is going to be different.
Yeah.
The whole wave is actually degenerating.
That's right. It's a damped oscillation, is really what we're saying.
I'm just wondering if there are any phase shifts, because that's one of the things that an FFT could. I mean, this is an ideal way for an FFT, and it's relatively easy to do.
Yeah, well, I hope you'll be on it by Monday afternoon. Okay, let me restart the Zoom. No, I'm restarting the Zoom. Zoom, yeah?
I have a question.
Okay.
About magnetic poles?
Yes, these could very well be magnetic reversals. Yeah, they very well could be magnetic reversals.
And what would be that digit?
What we're looking at is I'm suggesting they're ice ages. It was suggested that they're geomagnetic reversals. Geomagnetic reversals and ice ages may even have links to each other.
Do we see anything there that might indicate the increase of the human brain?
Well, we see that over here, a steep descent into novelty going deeper than we've ever gone before, and that would probably indicate that an animal or an organ is appeared of a density of complexity greater than anything which preceded it. So I would say yes.
How ago is that?
Well, let me start the Zoom and we'll get over in here on a big scale and then you can see. Okay, we're going to go from 5 million down to 2 million. Now let's discuss this, because this is the domain in which we evolved from. Our story is on screen at this point. It's said that the 100,000 years ago at the Colossus Cave river mouth in South Africa, there were Homo sapiens indistinguishable from the people sitting in this room. The oldest Homo sapiens skeletons are from there. That's clear over here. This is the pongide irradiation, meaning the proliferation of these primate forms. And that's about 900, a million years ago. This is the whole period in which the primates were breaking away from the rest of nature, and this is, I think, probably where the mushrooms begin to come into the picture and see how the whole system is propelled into lower levels of novelty than anything which preceded it. Higher levels of novelty. When the wave moves down, novelty is increasing. Zoom? Yes. See the minimum? No. That's one way of saying it, or increased density of connection, or it means something happening which has never happened before, which allows novelty to build upon itself. We talked about this a little bit yesterday, about how the early universe was very simple, and then came ordinary chemistry, and then organic chemistry, and then life, and then complex life, and then higher animals, and then primitive human beings, and then language and culture, and then computers and particle accelerators, and all of this representing steeper and steeper descents into novelty, headed toward a confrontation with novelty at infinite density, not millennia or millennia in the future, but 20 years from now.
It's not only that something's being created that was never created before, but it's being stored or imprinted in the entire system.
Conserved is the word I use, but yes, that's right.
And how does this relate to the fact that the last 20-year cycle of the Mayan calendar is ending on June 28th, and we're entering the supposedly last 20 years of the calendar? Is that, am I correct?
That's right. Well, when we get to the present, you'll be able to see, you know, the past few months, the next few months, the next few years. We approach it this way because I want to convince you that there's something sort of woo-woo about this thing. It does seem to have an uncanny predictive ability. Now, the most commonly met objection to this, and it may be forming in your mind, is that this guy just doesn't understand patterns, and that every pattern can be used to describe a different pattern. But I resist this because notice that this whole set of correlations is dependent upon this zero date which we inputted. If we shift the zero date, then all the other predictions would be thrown off. Well, now, naturally, if we shift the zero date 50 years, it's not going to have a hell of an effect on an event 175 million years ago. But if we move the date 50 years and we look at 1492, you know, it's all screwed up. You have to be right on the money when you get into the historical data field, because the historical data field can vary over a 24-hour period. I mean, John F. Kennedy dead, John F. Kennedy alive, the difference is 10 minutes. So it can be very highly quantified, specific, yeah. Enter. That's 2 million, roughly 3 million years on the screen. 1.5 million years on the screen. 700,000. Let's look at this for a minute. This is the last million years. And the last 100,000 years are right there. This is the emergence of modern human types, and it sets off the last cascade, at least at this scale. So all of this is evolutionary advance and climatological flux and so forth. And then from the time the modern human type emerges, it's a straight shot down in there. Now, obviously, we all know more about time as we get closer to the present. This is 366,000 years. It's 100,000 years up there. There's the last 200,000 years. There's the last 100,000 years. This is the environment in which we were shaped. These are these are climatological fluctuations here. This is the last glaciation.
Forgot. Shift to the computer, sorry.
Is it dying or is it having a good time?
I forgot it does that. Anyway, it's a very happy computer.
Why did you listen to that for me?
What are you doing this evening?
You can't. When Harry met Sally, remember that orgasm in the restaurant?
Remember the orgasm in the restaurant when Harry met Sally? Vaguely. Okay, this is the last 91,000 years. The glaciers melt here. The glacial melt begins around 19,000 years ago. And as you see, it's just a straight fall from there to the moon flight and to H. Ross Perot and to all the rest of it. And these are, again, episodes probably of glaciation or flux in the incidence of incoming cosmic radiation. It's hard to say what it is.
Focus on the last 3 or 4 days only.
Oh, yeah, we can go down. We can take it down to very small. Understand that the program does many wonderful things which we're not doing. I'm just doing a simple demo, but obviously all this stuff has got to be about something. Now we're getting into the area where people have real data. That's 45,000 years. 22,000 years on the screen. Let's look at this for a minute. This is worth talking about. Now the pressure begins to come on. It's all very well to predict interglacials that may or may not have occurred. Predicting assassinations of dynastic families is a little trickier. Here's the glacial melt begins. And species, this is the descent, this is where the mushroom paradise existed in its fullest expression from about 17,000 years ago to about 10,000 years ago. Well, now what is this sudden interruption of the descent into novelty here? I maintain, based on the archaeological record, that it's what is called the Tanged Point Technocomplex. Do you all know what that is? Does anybody know what it is? Tanged Point Technocomplex means that before this point, when an arrowhead is found, you find one. It means it was lost by somebody who was hunting. Around 10,000 BC, you begin to find large numbers of arrowheads all in one place without chipping fragments. This was not an arrowhead factory. This was the site of a battle between human populations. War is invented here. Because agriculture is invented here. You're looking at the end of the partnership paradise. The era of orgy gives way to the era of anxious monogamy, warfare, agriculture, egohood is born. Now, somebody asked about, who asked about Çatalhöyük? Somebody. Çatalhöyük, bottom of this stab here. The fire that burned through Çatal level 5A occurred in 6500 BC. We know this from charcoal dating. It's right there. It's on the money. See, somehow this whole Tang Point technocomplex bummer was overcome, and there was a steep descent into novelty. And Çatalhöyük was the product of that, but then it was destroyed and there was a rebound into chuckle-headedness for a while. And then right down here in the bottom of this thing is where the Great Pyramid is sitting. You know, the Great Pyramid was finished in September of 2970 BC. Why this should be so controversial, I do not understand, because there are grains of charcoal between the unmoved stones That charcoal has not been anywhere since the day that stone was set in place. And it's 2790 BC. These people who want to push it back and say it's 10,000 years old, well, the obligation to prove is on them because the carbon radiological data argues. You see, there's some tendency in the New Age, which I don't understand very well, that wants to make everything older than it is. You know, the pyramids are 50,000 years old, Atlantis rose and fell 100,000 years ago. The miracle is how new everything is. The pyramids were built day before yesterday. Charlemagne was king of France early this morning. It's all very, very recent. I mean, the emergence of mind out of non-mind is an event practically on top of us. Now let's start it up and we'll get really down to the...
Terence, does the progression of time change?
Well, yes, in a sense, because you see what happens is when you... It's a built-in mathematical property of this wave that when you get to the end of a big wave, there's, when you get to the end on any scale, there's a sudden drop to the next scale, and then it goes along to the end, and then there's a sudden drop. So if what we're saying is that a universe is made like a universe that actually had this structure that I outlined for you of 26 levels, where each level was 1/64 smaller than the level which preceded it, a universe built on that kind of architectonics would only be halfway through its life an hour and 35 minutes before the end. Do you see how that would work? That in the last hour and 35 minutes, it's going to go through as much development as it went through in the previous 72 billion years. So yes, time is accelerating into, you know, we've gone from barely moving to approaching a staggering speed. And I maintain, you know, that in 2012, the last 6 days preceding the approach to concrescence will be the jackpot. I mean, the laws of physics will break down. Everything will be in a state of visible, motile transformation. This isn't happening in the human world. It isn't happening in our minds. It's a crisis in the structure of physical law itself. And that's why this theory will be hard to disprove or prove until so close to the end date that you'll barely have time to make a telephone call to say whether it's true or not before, if it is true, your telephone call becomes totally irrelevant, you know.
What you're essentially saying is the fabric of space-time itself is being contorted, twisted, and
yeah, that's right.
That
no, that's right. And if that seems unlikely to you, let's never forget what the Orthodox guys are peddling. They're peddling the Big Bang theory, which says the universe sprang from nothing in a single instance. I would prefer what I call the big surprise cosmology, because it seems to me if you have to have a singularity, the least likely place to find a singularity would be in a featureless high vacuum. If you want to find a singularity, look in a corner of the universe where there are planets, stars, elements, organisms, alphabets, civilizations, minds. In other words, look in a complex domain if you want to find a singularity. That's where you might have some chance of finding it. But finding it in an unflawed nothingness is a strange place to look, even.
Except one of the arguments maybe being proposed by those on the fringe is that, in fact, it's a very complex universe that's been pushed through a membrane into the singularity, which then creates another entire...
Well, one possibility is that it's a wraparound, that we're not whistling Dixie when we talk about the archaic revival. What history is a finger reaching for the reset button. And when you finally touch it, you find yourself at the moment of the Big Bang. You know, you've actually sent it screaming back to the first moment.
So this is an exercise in holographics, in a sense. That final 6 days is a very pertinent, potent holographic description of the whole The whole day, the whole...
That's right. And every cycle is a holographic description of the cycles that preceded it.
We've just seen.
Right. So in 1945, when the bomb flickers into existence over Hiroshima, this is the resonance of the Big Bang. It's being caused by the Big Bang. And the entire life of the universe is then somehow reenacted in the remaining 67 years. In the same way, remember there was a 4,306-year cycle. We are reenacting that cycle in the present 67-year cycle. We have reached AD 700 right now. I mean, if you wonder why things are so benighted, it's because we're in the heart of the Dark Ages. You wonder why you can't understand the nature of the collapse of the state vector? Well, it's because you have an AD 700 intellectual machine looking at it. My God, the calculus hasn't been invented. Algebra hasn't been invented. The new world hasn't been discovered. These things will all happen ahead of us. Right now, we are in the heart of the Dark Ages. By the late 90s, we'll be closing distance with the Renaissance. Clearly, we have to put up with a bunch of Christer fundamentalism, epidemic diseases, and general knot-headedness until we get to that point. But then, after the turn of the century, we can expect the equivalent of Renaissance, the Industrial Reformation, the rise of Napoleon, the Civil War, Adolf Hitler. It'll just be coming quick, 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 quick. And finally, you know, it just pulls you in and everything happens at once. One way of thinking of this is that the entire rest of the future history of the universe is being compressed into the next 20 years.
Yeah.
But in other words, the heat death of the universe is 20 years away, essentially, is what is being suggested, because time is beginning to accelerate at such a rate that this compression factor is enormous. Okay, now let me see. What have we got? We've got 22,000 years on the screen, and we talked about it, so let me shift here. Oh, no. Zoom, yes. Set minimum, no.
Would humans be able to sense this acceleration of time?
Yes, I think, you know, Jeremy Rifkin wrote a book. Anybody read it? What was it called? Nobody read it. It was called... Anyway, the premise of the book was that time is accelerating, but he thought of it as social time, cultural time. I don't. I think it's embedded in the fabric of space-time itself. Yes, I think in a few... You see, you can only react to crises that you understand. So if I tell you the ozone hole is disappearing, you're alarmed. If I tell you an asteroid is going to strike the Earth, you're alarmed. But if I tell you that the Earth is about to collide with a hyperdimensional knot in the nexus of space-time, you know, but that's what's happening. Ahead of us is an enormous speed bump. We are colliding, we're about to collide with something that we can barely cognize. So it's hard to know what to think about it. Yeah.
This may be a little la-la and a bit simplistic, but consider this. You know, we all have experienced this sort of shifting of time and just the experience of one lifetime. You know, as a 2 or 3 year old, the moment as we experienced it seemed to last a longer period of time. I mean, my God, summer's lasted forever. Whatnot. We don't have that. And it's sort of, well, that's what happens over the course of a lifetime. What happens if consciousness shifts out to infinity? What happens to the moment then? It becomes vanishingly small, or in terms of the frequency...
It stops. Speed. It stops. Yeah, well, see...
Before it stops, it's speeding up. In other words, the span is becoming shorter and shorter. Say if you take a second, the second will become shorter. That means, in effect, that the whole process is speeding up until it collapses.
Yes, it's possible that dying takes forever.
Right.
You see.
That's a singularity.
And so, you know, you start to die, and then you die and die, and then you realize you're going to die forever and never approach it, because the seconds become stretched into millions of years. It's something like that. It's about, and I think psychedelics are about the fabric of time. When you strip away the hallucinations and the personal reference and the craziness, the bare bones of it are, it's about time. It illuminates what time is. Yeah.
Something I had to add to this is the movie The Highlander. They have a term called the quickening. And I've noticed a lot of people in ecstasy circles on X feel this sense of quickening time, of something approaching them when time is quickening towards that end point. And because people see more or less on ecstasy to be a lot more empathetic and genuine towards that.
Yeah, I mean, see, part of the problem with perceiving what's going on is that we're like mayflies or something. I mean, we live so briefly that to us it looks like the world is standing still. But in fact, staggering amounts of change are going on. I mean, the automobile is 100 years old, for crying out loud. We can't conceive of a reality without the automobile. So, and just in my lifetime, you know, I've seen immense change. So, and this is going to accelerate eventually to the point where I believe they'll hold conferences on the acceleration of time, and people will, boards will be appointed to try and figure out if anything can be done about it, and stuff like that.
I know you have a distaste for quantum physics, but there was a conference apparently last spring in Spain. Actually, it was a conference of astrophysics, I believe, because I heard some reports on it. And a serious topic of discussion was the fact is was the trying to attempt to answer the question, does time exist? I mean, this was being serious on the agenda at some astrophysics conference.
Yeah, time is the great misunderstood or ununderstood quantity in our lives, for sure.
Terence?
Yep?
You referred to the those orthodox guys and their Big Bang theory.
Right.
So you reject the Big Bang theory.
I don't necessarily reject it. I just think they shouldn't sneer at me when their theory is so cockamamie. I mean, in other words, I haven't proposed anything weirder than the Big Bang. It's saying that a universe can condense itself faster and faster down into a supernovel object sounds to me like a considerably more conservative statement than to say that a universe can spring from nothing for no reason in a single instant. They've cornered the market on the unlikely approach to cosmology.
Do you have any book to refer to as an alternative to that?
To their theory? No, but I'm going to write one.
Well, there's actually been a serious debate on the whole topic. I mean, there was a book recently published in the last year, Did the Big Bang Happen? It was written by another cosmologist.
Well, the Big Bang looked like it was in real trouble as recently as 6 months ago, but the new data from this, is it OGOS 3 or one of these satellites, they finally actually found irregularities in the microwave background. And until they found some irregularities, they were in a real mess because they couldn't figure out how you get from the super smooth initial conditions to the clumpy present situation. Now this new data appears to have pulled their chestnuts out of the fire. But I think the Big Bang may be in need of serious revision. I mean, you have the super inflationary cosmology as an attempt to fix some of those problems, but it gets, you know, there are problems, yeah.
Well, of course, if it's true that this derivation on the machine doesn't apply, then you would expect small fluctuations in the background radiation because of the fractal nature of what we're talking about.
That's right.
Very beginning. Also, as an aside, I mentioned it, in the Bible, Jesus said that things would be speeded up.
What did he say exactly?
I can't remember the exact quote, but he in effect said that events would be speeded up in the time.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. If we get a little deeper into this, we can even discuss maybe why he would have said such a thing, because I think we can illuminate it. Here, let's do a little more. We've got 22,000 years on the screen. 11,000 years on the screen, 5,000 and some. This is, in a way, my favorite screen, because this book I want to write, I'm going to call History's Fractal Mountain. And there it is, folks. History's Fractal Mountain. Chatalyayuk is over here in the bottom of this. Along this descending gradient here, like pearls on a string, you get the great ancient civilizations. Ur, Chaldea, Babylon, and Egypt. And this actually, the graph actually confirms the intuition of the theosophical mentality that Egypt did achieve some level of advance that was not surpassed until late Roman times. That there was a tremendous breakthrough on the part of these civilizations. This negative habitual or recidivist upward curve is studded with a whole bunch of warlike male dominator civilizations. The Hittites, the Mitanni, the Assyrians, and up here at the top, Mycenaean pirates overwhelm the last outpost of the goddess culture on Minoan Crete. This is Homer, right there. Homer sings his song, and if that to me fits, because I had a professor who once said to me, you want to know where it went wrong? I'll tell you where it went wrong. When these Greeks pulled their boats up on the shore and stopped being fishermen and started talking philosophy, the shit hit the fan. And that's precisely what happened. There it is. You see this steep, steep descent into novelty. And then, after the fall of Rome, oscillation around a mean where it's sort of up, it's sort of down, but there's no real progress until the Industrial Revolution of the 1740s.
Well, that makes sense, because any kind of attempt at descent into novelty or ascend into novelty would have been suppressed by the emerging church at the time.
That's right. Well, of course, this isn't Eurocentric, it's global.
Where did you go from BC to AD?
Oh, you mean where is the birth of Christ? Roughly, it's right here. There's a little kind of a choke, and then a very steep fall right afterwards. That's the birth of Christianity, of the Roman Empire versus the Republic, and so forth.
Because I read the dates here. I mean, these are all the BC numbers, 36
yeah.
BC. Be right about in there, then.
Yeah, it's
about
sort of
up at that minimum.
Yeah,
right
about there. Well, let's see. We may get it on the next pass.
So saying that novelty has now gone to centered around human civilization.
As
opposed to general species.
Well, why is it biological first?
Yeah.
And why is it human?
Well, it wasn't at first. It was physical. It was that. It was that atomic physics gave way to chemistry, which gave way to molecular biology, which gave way to life. It keeps moving, it keeps being active at the front of the wave, but it leaves a residuum behind it of these previously created structures. Right now, the wave is clearly lodged in our species, while everything else is under the aegis of Darwinian mechanics. We're apparently under the aegis of cultural mechanics.
Well, absolutely. It depends on the intensity of the prominent feature. You know, if a meteor came in the middle of some of this, it would obliterate what you're seeing there, and another feature would stand out more.
Yeah, that's right.
Not really being dominant or dictated by human life, but it just so happens that it's the most prominent
thing
feature.
Well, it's like the quantity being measured changed.
How so?
Right.
The source.
It seems like that first we are cosmological, now we're anthropic. And, you know, I'm really... This is very speculative stuff.
It builds on complexity. Wherever there is complexity, you will get more complexity. It doesn't build on simplicity. It builds on the last most complex achievement, see? So intelligence rests on animal organization, which rests on cellular biology, which rests on molecular biology, which rests on physical... You got it. Okay. 2.
Another feature that could be clarified by a transformer.
Now, pretty soon, there is the descent. Here, let's stop and look. The crucifixion is right there. And it's interesting, you know, Christ was an absolute contemporary of Caesar Augustus. So you get this great religious reformer at the same time that you get the great reformer of Roman polity. So two of the most important personalities who ever lived are alive at that point. That, strangely enough, does not win the prize. See this deep little chip here? If we were to blow that up and look at the bottom of that trough, there was a moment when you could have had a dinner party when Lao Tzu, Confucius, Mencius, Pythagoras, and Ezekiel could have all gotten drunk together had they been able to find each other right back there in the immediately preceding the Greek Renaissance. Now, the fall of Rome is in 475, right there. And you see how the time after the fall of Rome is all of a certain general character, clear up to 1700. And then certain technologies and mathematical techniques propel to an even deeper level of novelty. Now, the next screen is the one that I think is probably where we either win or lose you.
Look at the overall shape of that wave. It's clear that there's an overlying principle at work here. I mean, the birth and death of Christ is practically noise on that curve. There's a deep, strong move into novelty, and those superpositions of those events are relatively minor.
That's true.
He's arguing that maybe Christ was the blood.
Well, it just points out that it's not being driven by what we would perceive as.
No, it's not being driven by these great personalities. They are being driven by it. I'm sure that if you could have stepped into Christ's mind while he was undergoing the passion, the main question he was asking himself was, what is going on? You know, why do I say what I do? Why do I do what I do? I don't seem to be my own person. You know, I seem to be a puppet of some cosmic force, because he was a puppet of some cosmic force. You see, the transcendental object at the end of time is like one of those reflecto balls that hang in discos, you know? And as it turns and spins, it sends off distorted reflections of itself, which ricochet into the past. And if you are correctly situated, it'll turn you into a Christ or a Buddha or a Lao Tzu. If you're not quite correctly situated, it turns you into a Madame Blavatsky, a Meister Eckhart, in other words, second stringers. If you just get a little of it, well, then you're a person with strange insights and great personal charisma, and the people around you love you. We all are very close to this thing. Every night when you dream, you come into the presence of the transcendental object at the end of time. We are all distorted reflections of the last thing. And as we get closer and closer to the eschaton, the last thing, the distortion begins to leave. And you say, my God, it's like watching a photograph from an SX-70 develop. First it's just murk, and then you say, oh, there's a person there, and it's getting clearer and clearer. You know, we are actually being pulled into the attractor. The veils are being parted. The truth is becoming more and more and more eminent. And if in the final confrontation with it, you know, it's the apotheosis. The apocalypse, the apotheosis, the apocatastasis, a whole bunch of Greek words beginning with A.
We're all heads.
No.
Well, that would have meant things were going to really hairy by this Christmas.
Okay.
Did you enter a time span in there too?
Well, no, it picked up the time span that we had. See, it just accepted the correction. Thank you very much. Good thinking. Now, is it all right? Yes. Okay, now, this is the screen upon which the theory will stand or fall, because this is the screen that is filled with the history that we know. We're not talking fossil records or Chatalyuk or any of that. We're talking very precise dates. It's saying that there was a very steep descent into novelty around 948 AD. What is this?
What is this? What is this sector again?
1400 years. And this first steep descent into novelty is the intellectual flowering of Islam within the confines of the Umayyad and Abbasid caliphate and the invention of algebra, an intellectual tool that sets the stage for modern science. Essentially, this is the birth of modern science, and you see how steep, sudden, and precipitous it was. Okay, then you go over to this next one, and let me try something here since this is such a fast machine. See, I'm moving the little pointer, and it's telling me exactly what I'm pointing at. I haven't done this for you before, but this is very good for checking these things.
Oh, to know exactly the date.
To know exactly, yes. We're pointing at the exact date. And I want to get it over here to the bottom of this sucker. The First Crusade, the collapse of Fortress Europe. This is the beginning of the globalization of the European mind. We're dead on here. Okay, now the next steep descent into novelty is this one, obviously. Let's go over there and see what it is. There it is. 1358. I'm sorry, just a minute here. Let me get my ducks in a row. Okay. Do we all agree it's pointing at the bottom of the thing? Yes.
So that's the end of the novel, not the beginning of the novel.
No, that's the densest point of the novelty. It's 1354. What happened in 1354? That's right. One third of the population of Europe dies in an 18-month period beginning in late 1354. The greatest demographic collapse that Europe has ever experienced. It's an absolute hit, dead on. Now let's go over here to this. Now notice, though, that the recovery is quick. There's a steep descent into novelty and an almost immediate reversion back up to the same level of habit, exactly, business as usual. But this next one is different. It's a steep descent into novelty, and then it really stays down for a long time and explores this. So let's go over to the turning point, which is up at the top.
Terence, can you cross-reference this with Indian culture and Chinese culture?
It's global, but having said that, you have to notice that the world is now dominated by European values and culture. So while we can chart the ebb and flow of the Han Dynasty, at this point, European culture is moving to the fore because European culture is beginning to put its imprint on all of world history.